around its roll axis. It obviously has to roll around somewhere, but that's not necessarily the kinematic axis that you drew up in a sheet of paper at the design level of your car. There is a paper that I've referred to a little later by the late Bill Mitchell, which talks about four space roll centers. And that's a paper that I'll give you a link to, and you should look for to understand what we're talking about with roll. Roll is also important in keeping your aerodynamic package at the correct angle of attack to the ground. If you're using an undercar Venturi and the car rolls, that tends to break the seal on the outside and allows outside pressure in underneath the car and destroys your downforce. Okay, moving along a little bit. Jacking. Okay, this is the tendency of the car to rise when subjected to lateral loads. And again, people will talk to you about this being related to the height of the roll center. The reason for my silence there is that it is partially because it's obviously a car with a very high roll axis or roll center will have more of a tendency to jack than a car with a low roll center. But it's actually not the roll center as such. It's actually the instant center, where the instant center is. So if once you draw your suspension lines out, you'll have basically a jacking line that goes from outside tire contact patch out to wherever the instant center is. And that's actually the line around which the car is going to roll. Okay, I've popped onto the next slide, and that just showed, so here's the load path when we're braking. So as I said, all the forces, and this is the inertial force when we're braking, is passing through the center of gravity of the car. Whoops, go back. Passing through the center of gravity and is being reacted in the opposite direction at the front contact patch of the tire. Important to have that picture in your mind and to remember it. You also must remember that there is a lower reaction force at the rear tire, but the rear brakes are doing much less effort than the front brakes. Moving on. In acceleration, the same story. Now you'll notice here, there is no reaction at the front of the car because we're assuming here that we have a two-wheel drive, rear-wheel drive standard formula SAE car. If the car is an all-wheel drive electric car, there certainly will be a road reaction at the front of the car, and that adds a complication that I'm not going to go into here. Right. When a team considers implementing anti-dive into their design, they must realize that any lack of compliance in the front tires, or in the tires, any tires, is going to reduce that tire's grip. The object of the exercise, with your suspension geometry, your damper rates, your spring rates, anti-dive, anti-squat, all of those other things, is to keep your tire happy at the contact patch. That's the secret. Keeping your tires happy is of the utmost importance. Now, what happens with the majority of anti-dive systems is that you transfer you're transferring the load not through the springs and dampers into the car, but actually through the suspension arms, which loads them up, but effectively makes the front of the car rigid with some systems. So we have to think about what we're achieving there. I'll talk about some more about that in just a moment. Okay. This little simple corner model is so you can understand what I'm talking about here. We have here the sprung mass, which is the chassis and driver and engine and whatnot. Riding on the chassis springs, here's the damper. Then we have the unsprung mass, which is the wheel and brake, axles and suspension components and whatnot. And here's the spring in the tire. Well, obviously, the force, the spring force required to keep this off the ground is the sum of these two, is the sum of these two spring rates. So if you add to that spring rate, if you stiffen that spring rate so that it has less compliance, then more of the load is actually going to be transferred to this spring, which is the tire, which basically loads the tire spring and can materially affect your actual road grip. Now, there are people who will argue, and probably rightly so, that putting more weight on the front tires actually increases the grip. And that may be so on a nice, smooth surface, but most surfaces that I've seen Formula Student events run on are often far from smooth, and we end up with bumps and ridges and gutters and various things. And it's at that point that you're liable to lose contact, and actually possibly lock up a front wheel. All right, I'll move along. Okay. Basic fundamental anti-dive can be achieved by forcing the wheel to travel in a direction opposite the direction of travel of the car. In other words, as the wheel travels upwards, it also travels forwards. This is dreadful because it effectively locks the front suspension solid. The drivers hate it. It's a system that's being used, and probably the only system that you can use on a car that actually has inboard brakes, because quite a bit of the smarter anti-dive that you'll design actually uses some of the brake torque that's generated around the front spindle to actually assist with your anti-dive. Anti-dive can be achieved by forcing the wheel to travel in the opposite direction, as I just said, or by pivoting the suspension members on non-parallel axes, effectively locking the suspension movement and preventing the front of the car from dipping. As I said, this also reduces compliance of the front tires, or you take away ride compliance and destroy the grip of the front of the car. Another reason why you lock front wheels up. We're talking here about, that's another drawing that I've put in there. So you can see here, here's the upright, upper and lower ball joints. Here's the brake caliper, here's the brake disc, and here's the center of gravity. So in essence, we're going to look at an anti-dive system that actually causes the brake torque, the geometry that you're designing actually causes the caster to increase slightly. In other words, the top ball joint to move backwards as the front of the car dips. This force is countered by the force on the brake caliper from the brake rotor, which is turning in the opposite direction and actually locking up the operation of the front suspension. Shown here, we've got the loads. Okay. Now, here we've got zero anti-dive, and there is a lot to be said for zero anti-dive. Okay. If the top and bottom axes at the chassis of the suspension pivots, top and bottom, are actually parallel, there is no brake torque anti-dive. There is no locking, binding motion of the four bar assembly that's your front suspension. And so there is no anti-dive. Now, there are, of course, other ways of having anti-dive. You can have, a third suspension element, which actually only operates in dive or in squat if you have it on the rear of the car. And we'll talk about that later in this little talk. If that's the type of suspension design that you wish to use, this would be the suspension design that I would suggest to you. Mainly because it gives good compliance, the wheel can follow the ground even when you're braking hard, and hopefully give you good grip. And I'm making an assumption here. I'm assuming that the good drivers here will all trail brake. By that I mean they don't just do all their braking in a straight line. They actually brake when they're turning into the apex of the corner. If you're not doing that, you're not going fast. The problem with that, of course, is that as you turn the steering wheel, the caster and KPI effect multiplied by the scrub radius on the front suspension means that one front wheel is going to get light, and that one front wheel will probably start to lock up. So it's important to try and maintain as much tire grip as you possibly can, which is the reason why I'm sounding negative about introducing geometrical anti-dive into the front of the car. Okay, we'll move along a little bit. In this case, we have the suspension axes are still parallel, but this time they're sloped down at the back. Now, this is pro dive for a number of reasons. It's pro dive because, as you can see, the forward transfer of weight transfer of the car is pushing into the suspension geometry to push the front of the car down. But also, if you look at it another way, the backwards, like the rearwards force, the road force on the wheel, which is transferred to the suspension through these through the suspension members, is actually pushing the chassis down along this axis. So this is make a tendency for the wheel to dive. However, it's not necessarily a total loss. One benefit that we can see is now the wheel will travel backwards slightly in bump, and that increases the compliance and increases the load, increases the ability of the tire to maintain good traction under brakes, and actually wouldn't be a bad solution if you're going to use a third element, like another brake, another spring arranged to counteract dive in the front suspension. But it's important to understand that that's the suspension, the loads from the wheel to suspension are actually pushing the car down at the front and thus promoting dive. Okay, here's the first type of anti-dive, one that I spoke about earlier, where the axes of the suspension is actually tilted upwards, but they're parallel. The wheel travels forward as it bumps, so this really, in effect, just locks the system forward. You can also see that the forces being transmitted from the wheel through the suspension pickup points into the chassis are actually pointed upwards, which is holding up the front of the car. This is just literally locking up the front of the car. Not a good solution. Okay, we'll move on a little bit. Okay, we've just covered that, haven't we? It's just, that's another copy of the previous slide, but this time I've put some arrows in to show the direction of the forces that are being fed into the chassis, which are jacking it up. Okay, as you can see here, this is still the same type of anti-dive, and now the little arrows show the brake torque. The brake torque is doing nothing because there is no torque being applied to the upright assembly, turning the caliper in a direction counter to the direction of the brake disc. Okay, a little bit of history here. The little red and white race car that you see in the corner is a very famous historic race car. It was a ground braking design back in about 1970. God, that's 50 years ago. How old am I? There was no brake torque. There was obviously no brake torque. So this car, incidentally, had inboard front brakes. So the brakes were driven by a shaft from the wheel. So the brake forces were reacted directly into the chassis, not through the suspension members. This was done to try to keep that wedge-shaped car at the right aero angle in braking and in cornering. However, the drivers couldn't drive it. It was an absolute disaster. However, once the car was modified to take that anti-dive out and have parallel suspension, that car became one of the all-time great Formula One cars that won world championships over a series of years, won a lot of Grand Prix, and won a lot of... Yeah. So we have there a situation where that's we've seen, that's anti-dive, that's the first time of anti-dive. The very basic, very crude form of anti-dive, and certainly one I would not recommend to you. Okay, the second type is we've got here that we have the suspension pivots are now non-parallel. That means that the bottom wishbone moves slightly forward and the top wishbone moves slightly backwards as the suspension compresses. That increases the caster and turns the caliper in a direction counter to the brake disc rotation, and it will introduce some anti-dive. There is little anti-dive here because the forces being reacted from the road force on the bottom wishbone is actually being pushed upwards. Oops, done it again. And on the top wishbone is actually being pushed downwards. So these forces effectively cancel each other. So the only anti-dive that we get here is really from the brake torque. As you can see, the wheel travels in a slightly rearward motion as it compresses. So that will add to the compliance. So yeah, it's a brake system that you could use, an anti-dive system that you could use effectively if you so wished. Okay. This car has we've said, as inboard brakes. And in this case, there is no brake torque. So the wheel will just travel effectively vertically. There is no anti-dive here at all. So you cannot use this non-parallel axis type of geometry to generate anti-dive in the front of a car that's got inboard brakes. All right, we'll talk about squat when accelerating. Obviously, you can't generate as much G-force accelerating as you can braking. So squat is probably not really so important. It is important, however, to have fairly compliant brake spring rates at the rear of the car in order to maintain good traction. Okay. If the rear of the suspension axes are parallel to each other, as shown in this picture, the inertia of the car is moving backwards. The wheel is driving forwards and driving the forces into the chassis on a parallel axis. So there is, in fact, no anti-squat here. There is, however, something else going on, and that's the drive effect under acceleration, which will actually try to make the car wheelie. If you think about the chain pull, like that chain is pulling hard on the top run, which is trying to pull the engine sprocket back against the force on the ground, and will tend to move weight transfer from the front of the car to the back of the car, and probably increases the squat. So if you have parallel geometry as we had here, and aligned with brake torque and acceleration, that will actually cause the car to squat, an additional force to make the car squat more than, or not more than, but additional to the weight transfer that you get as the car moves off the line in acceleration. Obviously, this effect gets less as the speed increases because the weight transfer to the rear decreases. This is at its highest as you move away from the start line, say in the acceleration event, and then it decreases as the car's speed increases. That's why the judges watching the acceleration event can actually tell whether somebody's got a good run or not by how the car handles in the first two meters. We know if the car gets out of the start line at the first 2 meters fast without doing anything squirrely, it's probably going to be a good run. Okay. Anti-squat, absolute opposite of anti-dive. Here we have the drive force pushing forward. Those forces reacted into the chassis through the suspension geometry, push upwards, and that holds the back of the car up as the car accelerates. So that's geometry to inhibit squat. It also means that the wheel will travel backwards in a bump, which also enhances traction, which is more important at the back than it is at the front. Right, where are we? Okay. If you slope the suspension axis towards each other too much, what ends up, it will have an anti-squat effect, of course, but it will also cause binding of the four-bar suspension mechanism, effectively locking up the rear suspension. This will then cause all of the load to be transferred into the tire, upsets the tire of the contact patch, as not good for traction. So you can have too much of a good thing. Okay, that's even more so. You can see there the forces being forced into the chassis are opposite to each other. So there is effectively no anti-squat there at all. Okay, what do we have to do? If you slope the suspension axis towards each other in the front, it will have little attitude from the effect of drive thrust. So even though you may have some anti-squat by the geometry change, it won't actually be affected by the drive thrust, because that will be basically cancel each other by passing in these two opposing angles. It's very late here, by the way. It's midnight, so pardon me if I sound a bit tired. Okay, we're now going to talk about a different matter, and that's using a third element anti-pitch. This little drawing here, you have to have a look at a drawing here. So we've got an ordinary pushrod car, bell cranks operate the shock absorbers, and the shock absorbers drive this device here, which is a T-bar anti-roll bar. The torsion bar part of the anti-roll bar, the part that twists, is parallel to the center line of the car. But that old bar can move up and down and not impart any suspension stiffness on its own unless we introduce a third spring. Now, this third spring can be rubber buffers, it can be bevel washers, it can be a coil spring and damper unit. But this is a spring which only operates when the car pitches. In this case, we're looking at the front of the car. So when the car dives at the front, these two rockers will pitch down. They will drive this T-bar down, which will compress this spring and inhibit dive at the front. When the car rolls, this bell crank pitches down, this bell crank pitches up. That twists the anti-roll bar, but it makes no difference to the length of this spring. There is no compression on this spring. So there is no additional spring rate added in corner or in ride. However, only in dive. It's a nice, elegant solution, and it's effectively what's used by most modern race cars. It's called a third element. You can, of course, have the exact same thing at the rear of the car for pitch. I do have some pictures elsewhere, not in this presentation, but I do have some pictures which, if we have a little time, I might have a look at. Okay, the other thing we're going to have a look at here is anti-roll. Here's the guy who stopped the car from rolling. Okay, where are we? Okay, Generally, a car rolls under the effect of lateral force pushing against the center of the center of gravity and reacted by the contact patch of the tire. This causes the unsprung mass to roll inside between the wheels. That's not necessarily a good thing. It's not necessarily a bad thing, but if excessive roll can cause the wheels to adopt some strange camber angles, particularly if it generates some positive camber on the loaded front wheel, and therefore reduce grip. Normally how this is handled is a torsion bar is fitted in the car with actuating arms that actually work off the suspension that twist this torsion bar and therefore it contradicts the chassis rolling. It becomes a torsion bar which only operates supposedly when the chassis rolls within the suspension. However, it doesn't just do that. Because of the way it's done, it also operates as a spring in a one-wheel bump. So it stiffens the spring. And remember, this spring is not damped. You may have damping on the road spring, but the anti-roll bar spring is not damped. And the other thing is that if you hit a one-wheel bump, it pushes the torsion bar up, adds the spring rate, but it also wants to lift the other front wheel. So in effect, what it's done, it's made your independent suspension not quite so independent. It's a fairly common solution. It's an extremely useful tool for tuning the car, tuning the roll distribution of the car front and back. In essence, as a quick rule of thumb, a stiffening the front anti-roll bar will generate a little more understeer. Stiffening the rear anti-roll bar will generate a little bit more oversteer. So it basically, by stiffening it, you reduce the grip at that end of the car. I'm not so sure that reducing the grip at either end of the car is what you need to be doing. I'd be looking at increasing the grip. But you will find that if you turn up at a former student event and you do not have some form of anti-roll control, then the judges will ask, why not? A typical scenario in real motorsport is where you have rain between practice and the actual competition, and a quick way to soften up the car to make it more effective on a low grips track is to reduce the anti-roll effect. Here we can see that that's the torsion bar being actuated by the roll device. There are other ways of doing it. Remember this. Here we have our bell cranks and dampers and God knows what. And here's our anti-roll bar, the anti-roll bar that we used earlier as part of our third spring unit. But in this case, it's just being used. It's a longitudinal torsion bar. It's being twisted by this T-bar. Another type is similar, but instead of having a torsion bar in the center, they actually have flexible wings on the T-bar so that the T-bar becomes, in fact, the anti-roll bar. Again, though, what it's doing is a one-wheel bump. Look at the load path, wheel into push rod, pushes this down, pushes this one up, changes the load on that wheel. So, but still, it's a good solution. Okay, that brings us to our old friend jacking. This thing that I call the jacking triangle is that there is a relationship between the track width and the center of gravity height. Obviously, the wider you can make the track, or the lower you can get the center of gravity, the less jacking effect you'll have in the car. Obviously, you cannot make the track too wide because you have to get through the slaloms, but that brings up another issue. It's been popular in recent years for teams to build very narrow cars, narrow track cars. The reason they give for this is that it helps them get through the slaloms very quickly, and it probably does. The downside is that in a high G corner, the car wants to trip over the outside wheel and actually lifts the inside wheels off the ground. Now, at many events, if the judges see the car on two wheels more than one or two times, they will in fact black flag it. They decide that's an unsafe situation. So we need to think about jacking and the jacking angle, what's making the car jack. When you understand what's making the car jack, it's quite easy to understand what you've got to do to avoid it. Okay, we have here the center of gravity of the car. It's being reacted into the ground. The lateral force comes on here, and the jacking effect is at right angles to there. So in fact, what the car is trying to do is to pole vault over the outside, over the outside contact patch. Remember, we spoke earlier about only having 50 millimeters of travel, and that means only 25 millimeters of wheel travel. That's not very much at the outside front wheel. So it's only a very small amount of wheel travel before the entire jacking effect is being loaded into the car, and the car wants to pick the inside wheels off the ground. The effect can be seen there, and that's what happens. As I said, I don't know what the rules are of Formula Student Russia, but certainly in Germany and the UK and various other places, if you get up on two wheels with any repeatedly, you'll be shown a black flag. Okay, that's another thing. Jacking distribution, of course, is controlled by the position of the center of gravity in the wheelbase. Remember, it's unlikely that the center of gravity is going to be 50% halfway between the front and rear axles. So obviously there's a greater jacking effect at one end of the car than the other. Also remember that your wheel rates are going to be softer at the rear than they are at the front, for reasons that we mentioned before. Okay, now down to discussion. I've rushed through this a little bit because I knew we had to get finished by midnight here in order for you to have your presentation. But Andre, are there any questions?
I think we should give some time for students to understand if they have any question, because the lecture was pretty interesting and some time is really needed.
Of course. I can stay here as long as you wish. So if they have questions, start asking. Should we go back just to leave this up, because actually whilst you look for questions, I'm going to find another display, another presentation. Oops. I talked before about a third spring arrangement. This is a classic example. Here we have the torsion bar, which is the anti-roll bar. Here's the cross piece, which is operated by the rockers. Here are the road springs that operate on the rockers. And here is the third spring mounted to the chassis. This is an anti-dive spring. This is the front of the car. Very clear and easy to see in that description. The same car has a similar arrangement at the rear. Here is the rear suspension of the car, the drive shafts back here. This is not a Formula Student car, by the way. It doesn't matter what it is. But so here are the ride springs operated by the bell cranks. Here is the anti-roll bar, this black bar down here, and the T-piece operated by these pull rods or push rods from the bell cranks, and then feeding into the third spring and shock absorber arrangement. which is to prevent squat. This car, if you see the whole car, you can see it's actually got a huge aero package. And so they work very hard at keeping the car flat and level in order to keep the right angle of attack on their aero package. There's another variation. Here we have the bell cranks. This is looking down at the top of the car. So here we have the push rods coming up from the suspension operating the bell cranks. The bell cranks drive the ride springs. There are two short links to the cross piece, the T-bar, which operates, in this case, a single push rod to a stack of Belleville washers, sprung washers. So that's the spring that that prevents this car from diving. That's a Formula 3 Dallara. Actually, that's the back of the car, looking at the drive. Yeah, looking at the back. So that's anti-squat, but it's still a Formula 3 Dallara. Time for some bullshooting.
So it seems like all the students have no questions.
Okay, are you going to give them a copy of the handout?
Okay, so maybe a few days later I will send the presentation to all the students. And first of all, I want to say a big thank you to you, Pat.
Look, it's I'm sorry I had to rush it a little bit, but you told me that we were on a bit of a tight deadline and we had a late start, but that's okay. So I think we got the message across. It's not remotely the same. I got to say, I don't really like this. And the reason I don't like this is because there is no personal relationship between the lecturer and the students. It's that always works much better when you can talk directly to the people. I mean, you know, we're stuck with this bloody virus and we haven't any other option, but nonetheless, hopefully we don't ever have to do this again.
Yeah, of course. Probably next year we will be here on site altogether.
Yeah, I hope so. I'd like to thank all the attendees for coming. Under the circumstances, you know, it's been a long weekend for them, storms and bad weather and various other things. And they probably all just want to pack up and go home. But to come and listen to me, thank you very much. Hopefully I've been able to help a little bit with taking some of the mystery out of the antis. Once you understand the basics, it's not such a big deal. And tell them to remember to keep their tires happy.
Okay, so it's a good picture to stop our presentation lecture. And
I'll tell you what I'll do. I will run off notes for this presentation, and I'll send it to you, and you can send that out to the students too. It's another presentation about keeping your tires happy. As an extra benefit. You like that? That's what happens when you put tire compound on your tires. It talks a little bit about dampers. It talks about the development of long travel suspension, where it came from. And one interesting thing, is the audience still there or have they left? Are they still listening or is it just you and me?
Okay, so... Actually, we should proceed forward to the award ceremony.
Okay, we'll close this down and we can then let you get onto your award ceremony and we'll talk later. Okay. Okay, thanks very much. Good night all. And I'm going to bed because it's 12:15 here in Sydney. And hope have fun. Don't get too drunk at the ceremony. And we'll see you all next year. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Pat.